Hello YouTube. Hello, I'm here today to talk about Ridley Scott's Exodus, Gods and Kings, and Aronofsky's Nowhere. I enjoy both equally. I enjoy both equally. Well, firstly, I'll kick off by saying I'm of no religious persuasion. Absolutely none whatsoever. I enjoyed both movies equally in regards to their narrative from A to Z and the satisfaction I got from watching both as a pair of movies, yeah. Obviously I'm recommending both movies based on that, but I thought I'd just give a little discussion, open a discussion potentially, and give a little talk on both movies, starting with X. The first thing I will say is John Turturro and the movie Kingpin. Yeah. The actor John Turturro, who plays Seti in Exodus, all I can say is Kingpin. I know he's been in the first thing I thought of when I started watching it was the movie Kingpin. He's been in the third Transformers film of late also. He's obviously been in loads of films since Kingpin. But just check out Kingpin and you'll know what I mean by it. When I've got a tongue-in-cheek there when I say check out the movie Kingpin. John Turturro is unrecognisable in Exodus. Absolutely unrecognisable. As soon as I'm talking about actors firstly, but players I call them. Tara Fitzgerald, the player Tara Fitzgerald, and the movie Brassed Off. See the female picture there, That's the actress Tara Fitzgerald, and that's the only other movie I've seen Tara Fitzgerald in before this. Again, unrecognisable when I was watching Exodus, but whereas I didn't, in her case, I knew I'd seen the actress before, whereas with John Turturro, I just couldn't. I just didn't have any inkling whatsoever with John Turturro, but with Tara Fitzgerald, I knew I'd seen her before. Whereas John Turturro, I had no clue. It was just dead strange. I had this strange recognisability, and I had this strange familiarity with John Turturro, but I didn't have a clue whether he was a singer, a player. I just didn't know what type of celebrity he was. Whereas I knew Tara Fitzgerald was an actress, get me, right? It was lovely to see her in Exodus. I'd only seen her in Brassed Off. She was so young in this, Brassed Off. She must have only been about 18, 19. She's about my age now in Exodus. She's probably slightly older, in fact. I'd only ever seen her in Brassed Off. Tara Fitzgerald. She looks like a mature woman now. She looks like a woman who's had kids, etc., etc., which she has done, and she's gone through a divorce in real life. Check out the movie Brassed Off, like with Kingpin, in regards to Tara Fitzgerald. Another player from Exodus, Joel Edgerton. Joel Edgerton, I thought, was terribly miscast. Completely and utterly miscast. He didn't even have the physicality of what I consider an Egyptian. He has the physique of a Viking, get me, of a Swedish fella, a Norwegian fella, a Scotsman even. Doesn't have the physicality. He has this attractive Aussie twang, South African almost, But it actually, for me, it made him stand out even more as a slow thumb because of my already feelings for him, for being, based on his looks alone, terribly miscast for his part in Exodus. So terribly miscast. I thought Christian Bale, wonderful. I thought he was perfectly cast, actually. Christian Bale, perfectly cast. In regards to Sigourney Weaver and Ben Kingsley, I've heard in reviews for this movie that it was a shame that they weren't in the movie enough, that they were underused. I thought they were used just fine, again. As with the quality of casting for Christian Bale, I thought Weaver and Kingsley were fine, were in the movie. They weren't in it too little, too much. It was a case of quality over quantity with the pair of them. I thought they were in the movie just fine. I think they were spot on. I think their characters, as I say, less was more with the pair of them. I actually found with Ben Kingsley, I find him quite unpalatable actually as an actor. There is not much of a movie I can watch with Ben Kingsley in. Hugo, I can't watch the movie Hugo. I find him unpalatable in Hugo. I only watch Hugo because it's the 3D movie. Ben Kingsley, I actually found him attractive in Exodus. I thought he acted. I thought his quality was great in Exodus. I thought he played a great part in Exodus. Whether it's down to the direction, whether or not Scott had the nerve to film Ben Kingsley as the actor rather than Ben Kingsley as the Academy Awards winner, whether it's due to Scott having the nerve to do that and previous directors not having the nerve to do that, as to my distaste for Kingsley as a player, I don't know. But as far as Kingsley goes for Exodus, best film, best movie I've ever seen him in. I thought he was wonderful in it. Wonderful. Other players in Exodus, before I move on. The main players. No, that's it. I think in regards to the main players, Aaron Paul. I thought Aaron Paul was wonderful in this. Aaron Paul has a general player, he has this intensity in his eyes, which he brought to Need for Speed. He has this real intensity within him. He has this real intense look about him. And it's within his eyes, whether it's... He tends to, like, look and has, like, a snarl, sort of, like, an intense, like, almost aggressive look to him. Frustrated look, almost. A very anxious look, almost. Which I found irritated me in Need for Speed. He put on too much weight for Need for Speed as well, so he just looked like an angry hamster in this all throughout, and it pissed me off actually because he was just like a tubby little hamster in it with this horrible look, and I didn't like it. Frustrated hamster, he looked in that, and I didn't like him in Need for Speed. I thought he just ruined the movie for me in this. As I've discussed with this movie, Need for Speed, I thought it was great, etc, etc. Check out a previous video I've done for that. I thought this movie was handled great all round. But Aaron Paul, I thought his intensity brought to this movie didn't suit. I thought the intensity brings as a player to this movie, Exodus, I thought was spot on. I thought it suited his character as Moses' left-hand man, right-hand man almost. He brought the intensity needed to pull off that part perfectly, I thought. I thought it was Aaron Paul's best outing so far. Obviously, since he's left that TV series, what's it called? But yeah. Let me just check it. What's it called? Aaron Paul. Breaking Bad. Yeah, he does. He has this mad stare in his eye, doesn't he? I've just checked out the post, the picture there, Wikipedia reviews. He has this mad, crazed look in his eyes, which I thought didn't suit Need for Speed. I think he generally, generically has it. I don't think he's ever going to be able to lose it. His gun might find it difficult to find parts in the future. I don't know which suits it. I thought it was spot on for the character he played in Exodus. Spot on. Spot on. Who else? No, in regards to players for Exodus, I think I've covered that fine. Now, I'm going to move on now to the movie Noah and the players. I'm going to comment on the players in that movie. And I'm going to be back in a minute. I'm going to upload this. Back in a minute. And now for the players in Noah. Russell Crowe. I thought Russell Crowe... I'm not a massive fan of Russell Crowe. He must have worked out. He must have worked very hard on his physicality, because he's in excellent shape for this movie. Regardless of how he looks in the later stages of the movie. In regards to how unkempt he looks regarding his hair, his beard, etc. Most of the film, before he goes crazy, so to speak, he looks great for his age. He certainly is older than I, Russell Crowe is. He must be early 50s. Russell Crowe, he looks great in this movie, and he must have worked so hard to ensure that he did. I know how hard it is to take care of oneself. I know how hard it is as one is getting older, so to speak. So for an older gentleman again, Russell Crowe, it's just great to see him looking so great in movies. Remember, Gladiator must have been 20 years ago now. And also, Jennifer Connelly, again, Jennifer Connelly, last time I saw Jennifer Connelly in the movie was Ang Lee's Hulk. She is older again. Now, I say the stress is for Jennifer Connelly, because I remember Jennifer Connelly for being very curvaceous. She's lost all that femininity, just like the girl in Exodus. What's her name? Bear with me. Just like the girl in Exodus. That's how I think the ageing thing is affected. The actress who played Miriam in Exodus, yeah? That's how I think she's aged, so to speak, as a woman. The femininity, that obvious femininity has been left behind. It certainly has with Jennifer Connelly. She's like a boy now. She's like a little boy in this movie. Jennifer Connelly is like a little boy in it. She's lost all her femininity, her obvious femininity, so to speak. An extremely dramatic role for Jennifer Connelly toward in the latter part of the narrative, when Jennifer Connelly is trying to convince Crowe's character to not carry out his plan to ensure that the human race don't continue, so to speak, in the new world. That little 5-minute section, I thought Jennifer Connelly and was wonderful. And it was all in one take as well. I think the chemistry there proved wonderful. Ray Winston. Marvellous. I thought the chemistry between Ray Winston and Logan Lerman was wonderful. Logan Lerman is the dude who's in Percy Jackson, the Percy Jackson franchise. I have not seen those movies. Logan Lerman's character, he was particularly well cast, I thought. He has this weak look about him. Someone who could falter, someone who could be persuaded, someone who could be easily persuaded, so to speak, within his character, in his nature. And I thought he was well cast to play a character with such a weakness, if you will. Now, that was that was the pivot for Crow and Winston's character. They both had that connection in Logan Lerman's character. That was the pivot for them both. That was the balance, so to speak, between those two. And I thought it worked great. I thought Logan Lerman played that part wonderful, where he was able to offer that for the both main characters in the movie. Winston and Crow were both competing for Lerman's affections, basically, in the movie. The character Lerman was playing affections in the movie, and I thought he was wonderfully cast for that. Like the way Aaron Paul was just right in Exodus. I thought Logan Lerman was able to pull that off, but the actor Logan Lerman was able to pull that off great. And in the later movie, when he was able to, when his character redeemed itself, he was able to also put on a pair of shoulders and walk off into the sunset, if you will, which I didn't think he would. I didn't think he was so rounded, and he proved so to speak in Nowhere. I thought he was excellently cast at Logan Lerman in this movie, as I say Paul in Exodus was. I won't talk so much about Douglas Booth because I've never seen him before. Emma Watson, it was just good to see Emma Watson again in a movie since My Week with Marilyn. I've not seen her in anything since, really, that. It was great to see her. Wonderful, letting her hair down again in a movie, and it was great. She took to this role wonderfully. It was great. It was great. She was wonderful in it. I thought she would only have a minor role in this movie. I didn't appreciate how great her role was. Emma Watson, yeah, wonderful. It was great to see her with the English accent again. Fortunately, I feel Hopkins has passed it himself. He's type-caught himself, if you will, in the roles which I'm more used to him playing in regards to Hannibal. I couldn't stop thinking that when I was looking at him on screen, when I was watching him play the part he was playing in Noah, Anthony Hopkins. I couldn't help think, as I was looking at him, as I was watching him, Hannibal, and it took me right out of it, because Hopkins was playing the type of character that Hopkins was playing. He was playing a sympathetic role, trying to win over the family, trying to please the family, trying to grant their wishes, he was playing a grandfather in this movie, and I found it really difficult to switch off from the Hannibal roles. Hopkins has type called himself terribly. I think he was miscast for this role, the grandfather in Noah. I'll leave it there with Hopkins. I don't want to say he seemed, amongst a body of actors, he seemed inadequate. I don't want to say that with Hopkins. I don't want to say that. But I feel Hopkins was miscast. He was miscast for this particular role. I think, unfortunately, he has type-called himself to play such a sympathetic role as the grandfather in this movie, Noah. Other than that, yeah, I think the chemistry between the family and the family unit, chemistry between all the characters played by the actors, by the players, I thought the overall chemistry worked great. Extremely dramatic. Back in a minute. With the movie Exodus, we have one man's fight to gain equality under stroke from an oppressive rule stroke ruler stroke system, with a little help from the god he worships. with a loving and devout marriage stroke coming together of two people running through its core. Basically, it's a story, the Exodus story, as to how close it relates to how it's written, how well the screenplay is being constructed. I don't know. It makes for a interesting movie, an interesting watch, a spectacle. What we can learn from it, if we can learn anything from it, is to treat each other better. To see each other as equals, to see ourselves in our neighbour, and then to hope our neighbour sees him or herself in us, to treat each other like the way we would like to be treated ourselves, I think is the lesson which can be learned from the movie Exodus. I think the coming together, which I mentioned, the marriage of two people in the movie, which is Moses and his wife, I think with that running through the movie's core, envelopes the tale, envelopes the film, makes it a complete film, watchable, palatable film. It makes it satisfying, makes it come full circle, makes it very, very satisfying to watch. As I say, I'm of no religious bias whatsoever, and I found the movie thoroughly enjoyable and thoroughly satisfying to watch. Almost a tear in the eye when at the end of the movie Moses reunites with his wife, with his posse of people. I think and that's where the movie, really the narrative of the movie, like, departs. And then the final 5 minutes of the movie is where Moses is depicted as a lot older. He's seen very briefly scribing in the stone, the commandments, and then, say, he's seen very elderly before he takes his people on the journey, which is probably the greater story, actually, than the Exodus itself. Discuss Noah. Next. Now for Aronofsky's Noah. Now for this one. I have written a family's journey stroke fight to fruit the saviour's wishes to build an ark to survive a mass flooding. And that is the synopsis to Noah. I think Noah is just an entertaining fable as Exodus is. I think Noah is just as entertaining a fable. I think where all the animals enter the ark, the idea of the animals two by two entering the ark, the accumulation of the animals in the ark, the two by two to be saved, is up there with the believability of the parting of the Reed Sea in Exodus. I think in regards to both films as a pair of entertaining fables, as a pair of equally entertaining fables, both up there. totally up there in regards to their watchability, their rewatchability. As a pair of curiosities, they are a pair of outright curiosities. You couldn't script the pair of them. Pair of movies, you couldn't script the pair of them. Just pure entertaining fantasy, fantastically spectacled fables the pair of them are. I'm going to move on to the 3D next, what I think of the 3D for the pair of them. Okay, coming up. With Exodus, I found Scott had put together an extremely coherent and understandable and legible narrative / screenplay for the movie. Also, I noticed that he must have had 3D in mind whilst directing the movie, whilst organising and preparing the movie. He must have had 3D in mind. Obviously, he's had access to state-of-the-art visual effects. But having said and done, you've got movies left, right, and centre, which have been converted. I'm probably not shy of a few pennies. And have looked, and do look, bloody awful on their 3D counterparts, whereas Ridley Scott's Exodus is a masterpiece, an absolute glory in 3D on its Blu-ray 3D counterpart. Absolutely mind-blowing 3D I found in the movie Exodus. Absolutely can't find the words other than beyond perfection. I must have 20 or so titles on Blu-ray 3D, and cannot falter the 3D on the disc. Perfection. Aspect ratio 235 or 240. Noah Next, that is a 185 or a 178, filmed in a 178 or a 185 aspect ratio. A different animal altogether. We'll get onto that next. Hello, back again. Noah this time, Noah's 3D, like with Exodus. On its disc, with Noah on its disc, I was again dreading not being able to follow its narrative. Noah being the more fantastical out of the two. Fine, no problem. And again, I think 3D was in mind with this movie. It never got a wide 3D release. I think only in certain countries got it in 3D, but certainly got a 3D release in its steelbook. Certainly again, one would have thought to be granted a 3D movie because simply the way the movie was set up, again like Exodus with the preparation, like I was saying in my top 10 3D movies, any movie which has been filmed on a flat, of any kind, whether it be water, on a level, where it's whether it's a view of a landscape, any movie with like with filming taking place on a flat level, so you've got foreground, middle ground, and background. Any kind of movie which has been set up to be filmed with that kind of setup will look great in 3D, whether it's filmed in 3D or converted in 3D. That is why Exodus looks so good in its 3D form. Nowhere the game excelled in its 3D form, because like Exodus, it was prepared so like I touched on when I was talking about the Exodus 3D, Noah, a different animal, because it's in a 1.78 or 1.85 aspect ratio, something like that. It fills the whole screen, top to bottom. It's not letterboxed. I was thinking how fantastic would, touching on aspect ratio, how fantastic would Wizard of Oz look now in its 3D form if it was 16:9. They were just absolutely marvellous. I touched on Wizard of Oz because Noah is an extremely, it's magical and it's fantastical, simply because the bit about the animals coming on the ark, and the way they were gathering and coming on the ark over the period of the movie in stages, that is just so Wizard of Oz-y. And again, because you've got foreground, middle ground, background, the 3D looked great, right? So you've got like serpents and snakes coming out of your living room and into the ark, get me? And birds filling the back of the ark, right? Coming out from the left and right from your living room, going into the ark and shooting around the interiors of the ark, interiors, filling a 3D environment. Ideally, again, like I say, it's been set up so it looks wonderful in its 3D counterpart, Noah. The way it was set up, the way it was filmed. I'm trying to think which one I prefer overall the most, either Noah or Exodus, and I can't decide. I cannot decide. I love them both. Extremely watchable, both of them. I recommend.